Everyone, welcome to the Model Text Convention session again. This is the third session. This third session, I'll focus on the principle of distributing the taxon right between the contracting states. Well, there are four types of way to distributing types of way of distribution of the taxon right among the contracting states. So I'll explain in detail on the four types of them. And in the later section, I'll focus on especially on the taxing right allocation, especially on the business income, because business income is the main factor, main key of the on the allocation of taxing right between contracting states. And it has a OSD model and UN model applies the different aspect of the principle regarding allocation of taxing right between the contracting states. So I'll start. As I told you at the first and second session of our on the Model Tax Convention, I explained to you that one of the main objectives of the Model Tax Convention or the tax treaty is to eliminate the double taxation between the country on the income occurred in the international trade or transaction. So one of the way to eliminate the double taxation on the in the international transaction is just to divide the taxing right between the country of residence country and source country. So the main, well, if we get into deep into the Model Tax Convention or the tax treaty, one of the main objectives of tax treaty is to distribute the taxing right on the income between the contracting state. Well, that contracting state is, as I told you, is residence country and source country. One of the way for the elimination of the tax double taxation is sharing in their taxing right in a way they can share them, or one of the country, only one of the country between two country can claim the tax on certain income. So there are four types of them. I'll explain in detail one by one. First way is that the source country can have full taxing right on income. There is the first way to eliminate the double taxation on certain income. There is a second way, which is that the residence country, which is represented by R, residence country has a full taxing right on the income. This is the second way. Third way is just to share, sharing their taxing right between R, residence country, and S, source country. So in that sense, source country has only a limited taxing right on certain income. Fourth, well, I'll just briefly shorten in the term of effective management. So there is another way for the sharing of taxing right is that the income is only controlled, or their income tax is only imposed by the state who has the place of effective management. So basically, there are four types of them. I'll explain to you in detail. Well, as far as the Model Tax Convention is concerned, there are different ways of applying their principle here. Well, usually OECD model convention is emphasizing the right of the residence country, whereas on the contrary, the UN model is putting their emphasis on the taxing right of source country. So there is some difference in their model, especially many of the difference are occurred in applying these four types of principle in allocating taxing right between contracting states. So again, and this is the same diagram I draw at the first session. Well, let's just suppose that the same situation. S company pays some income to the R company. R company is the resident of state R, and S company is resident of state S. Because income is earned by R, as I told you, R country can claim that in certain type of income, R country can claim their taxation exclusively. And sometimes S country can claim their taxation on the income paid by S company to the R company. Third is they are just sharing their taxing right between R and S. This is the third way, by just limiting and the taxation of country S. Because S just impose a small amount of taxation on certain income, there is a space left over for the R company, R country, state R, can impose taxation on the income. And there is a rare case, but in some case, a place of effective management, state having place of effective management can claim their taxing right on income. So basically, in that case, there's no country, such as R or S, cannot claim their taxation in case where the state of EM, effective management, can claim their taxation on certain income. So first, I'll start with the income which the source country has a full taxing right on such income. Well, this is the income from immovable property. So the Model Tax Convention of OECD mentions that the income derived by the residents of the contracting state, which stands for R, from immovable property. So income from immovable property situated in the other contracting state, which is S, source country, may be taxed in that other state, S. This is the OECD model, Article 6, Para 1. Well, basically, what it says is like that the source country can impose tax on the income from immovable property when that immovable property is situated in that source country. So in this case, source country has privilege to tax on income accrued in their own territory. And well, because R is the residence country are also has a taxing right on income for its residents. However, because all the tax is taken by the country as there is little room, if any, little room to impose little room for the income of taxation, because as impose all the tax they can impose to the income on this type of income, all the thing R can do, state R can do, is to provide the elimination, provide the measures of elimination of double taxation, which is credit method or the exemption method I explained in the second session of our discussion. So in this case, there should be some space that the company state R can impose tax. There will be a very little money left over for the state R. Let's take the example here. Let's suppose that there is a $100 of income accrued in state X, and their they apply, state S apply 30% applied by S. And what the taxpayer has to pay is $30. And on the same amount of money here in the residence country, what they can, the tax rate they apply is, let's just assume that they apply the same 30% imposed by the state R. Then what they have is also the $30. Because they already pay $30 in S country, and what the taxpayer has to pay in our country is also the $30. What actually have to pay here in our territory or in the state R is $0, because it is already paid in the state S. So in this way, R may apply a measure of elimination of double taxation. Well, what R can do is just the leftover income. Let's just, for example, here, same example, $30 is imposed by S, and let's suppose that the tax rate of R is 40%. What R can impose taxation on income is $40. However, because they already pay $30 in country S, what they can impose, really impose, by R is only $10. In this way, there can be some room for the R country R to impose tax on taxpayer. There is a little room for the R to collect their taxes from taxpayer. And the income which state S has a full taxing right is, as I told you, immovable property, director's remuneration or director's fee. Income from sportsmen and entertainers and business income, if it is through permanent establishment. I'll explain this part in detail in the later session of this discussion. Second type is that the income which our residence country has full taxing right. For example, in the OECD model, royalty arising in the contracting states, which means S, and beneficially owned by the residents of other country, other contracting states, which is R, shall be taxable only in that state, which is R. So in case of royalty, as far as the OECD model is concerned, royalty income is only royalty income taxation on royalty income can be only levied by the state R. So source country doesn't have any right on imposing taxation on in case of royalty. So in this case, source country does not have a privilege to take tax on income accrued in S. Coming back to our examples here, well, although in case of royalty in OECD model, although income is incurred in the territory of S, country S doesn't have a right to tax on income. So in this way, a taxpayer, our company, can get has to pay all the money that has to be paid by our company is to the national tax service of our country. So as I told you, state R has full taxing right on the income for its residents, in this case our company, and the income which residents country has a full taxing right are capital gains of shares, royalties in OECD models, and pension incomes and student income, and business income which is earned not through PE. And third way is that the income which source country has a limited taxing right. So in this case, is as follows. Interest arising in income, in this case interest arising in a contracting state, which is S, and pay to the residents of the other contracting state, in this case R, may be taxed in that other state, which is R. So in this case, it is natural, but it mentions it makes it clear that the residence country has taxing right in any case on interest income. But at the same time, that interest income arising in the source country may also be taxed in the state according to the laws of that state. But if the beneficial of owner of the interest is the residents of other contracting state, which is R, the tax so charged shall not exceed 10% of the gross amount of interest. Well, which means that S can impose tax on interest income. For example, interest income is, let's suppose that again, $100. Well, source country can impose tax on this interest income, but the total amount of taxation imposed by the source country should be less than 10%. So maximum tax amount imposed that can be imposed by the source country is $10, which is the 10% of the gross amount of interest income, which is $100. So in this case, source country has limited right to tax on interest income accrued in S, in this case 10%, and R also has a full taxing right on income for its residents. Well, let's take the example again, coming back to the last example. If the residents R can impose tax of 40% on $100, what they have to pay is $40 in the case. But, well, the company R already pay tax of $10 here in the source country. What they have to pay is $30 in country R. So what the R country R can do is to provide, as I told you, the measure of elimination of double taxation. But level of relief may be lower because what they charge, what source country charge on income is lower than the first case, which the source country can have a full taxing right on the income. So in this case, source country has a limited taxing right. The income, that type of income are interest or dividend income and royalty under UN model. Well, in the OECD model, as far as the royalty is concerned, residence country has a full taxing right. However, in case of UN model, in the case of royalty income, source country has a limited taxing right on the royalty income. Developing country who has a little or small amount, small range of IP intellectual property, and they prefer this way of taxation instead of giving full taxing right to the residence country. And fourth type is to provide is that the taxing right is given to the state of effective management. Well, this is the one example. Profit from the operation of ships or aircraft in international traffic shall be taxable only in the contracting state who has the effective management. And what is the effective management? Effective management is, as I told you in the second session, is the place where the senior management is located. So regardless of their residence of their company, the place where the senior management is located is the place of effective management. Well, in this case, effective place of state of effective management has full taxing right on the income accrued in the international traffic or accrued in the source country. Many country, because this is complicated, basically tax treaty is between the treaty R between is the treaty between the R and S. Many countries choose the residence principle instead of EM principle. However, the reason behind and the applying the EM principle is that because in the case of international traffic, ships or aircraft are easily moved compared to the headquarter. So because it is easily escapable and many of their residents headquarters are located in low tax territory, the many country takes the approach of taking their taxing right on the company who don't have residence in their territory. But if their real senior management is located in their country, they would like to impose the taxation on the tax income occurred in the international traffic. So in summary, there are four types of international types of allocation of taxing right on income, and this is the income type I have explained to you. And well, attribution rule is the rule applied to the business income. Well, in case of business income, if the income is through the permanent establishment, I'll explain permanent establishment to you at the next session. But if income is carried through the permanent establishment, source country has a full taxing right. But if it is not through a permanent establishment, S doesn't have any taxing right on that business income. So permanent establishment is taxable in source country because of the level of participation in the economic life of source country. I'll skip this. Except for the one simple example. Let's just take the example again that the R company export car sale to the S company in located in source country. Well, they earn lots of money from the sales of car. However, if there's no branch office in here under the OECD model, there's no way to impose tax for the source country to impose tax on the car sales because there is no PE or branch office located in S. So as far as the business income is concerned, there should be some nexus in the source country, and that is that nexus is called permanent establishment. So in the OECD rule, profit is taxable, only taxable in the residence country unless there is a permanent establishment situated in the country S. No tax in S, no tax is levied by the source country if there's no PE in the source country. I'll skip this slide. In contrast to that attribution rule, there is another rule which is called force of attraction. First, in the case of force of attraction, all income is taxable. All income are taxable in the source country if there is any PE. Well, the comparison between the force of attraction rule and attribution rule is that whether the income should be carried through PE. In the attribution rule, income is taxable in S only if that income is through PE or carried their business through PE. However, in the case of the force of attraction rule, that income may be taxable in the source country whether or not that income is through PE. So I'll explain in detail at the next session, but this kind of principle, although it is limited one, is applied by UN model. So this is the two conflicting principle that the OECD model and UN model applies to. So this is the third session of our discussion on model tax convention, and I'll move to the fourth session. At there, I'll explain in detail about the permanent establishment and differences between the OECD model and UN models. Thank you.